Chief Medical Officer Jay Luxenberg provides medical leadership for the 5 Longmont corporations, both internally and externally. He is responsible for medical policy and oversees all medical affairs and clinical functions for both employed and contracted medical providers. He received his postgraduate training in geriatrics through a fellowship at Mount Zion Medical Center in San Francisco and a medical staff fellowship at the Section of Brain Aging and Dementia at the Laboratory of Neurosciences of the National Institute of Aging. Dr. Luxenberg completed training in internal medicine at Mount Sinai Medical Center in San Francisco, and he graduated medical school at age 22 from the 6-year combined biomedical program of Albany Medical College and Rensselaer Polytechnic Institute. Dr. Luxenberg's certifications include diplomat, American Board of Internal Medicine, and certification in geriatric medicine. He is a clinical professor in the Department of Medicine at the University of California, San Francisco. And he serves on the board of directors of the International Secondary Outreach Association. Dr. Luxenberg has been volunteering on committees for Onlock since 1988 and has served on the board of directors. He came to Onlock in 2011 from the Jewish Home in San Francisco, where he served as chief medical officer. Dr. Luxenberg is an author or will author of many research publications, book chapters, and 3 books related to eating. He has been invited to speak at many professional meetings internationally, and we're fortunate to have him here today. He has served as co-chair of the Alzheimer's and Dementia Expert Panel for the Mayor's Office in the City and County of San Francisco. Without further ado, please welcome our first speaker of the panel, Dr. J. Woo-hoo!
Thank you very much. So I was asked to state about depression and dementia. So I'd like to talk with you about smoking and lung cancer. So everybody is convinced that smoking is a risk factor for lung cancer. Any disagreement here? Okay, so that's pretty astounding. And one measure of that is in people with lung cancer, they're more likely to smoke than the general population. So that's pretty solid. But what I don't think anybody has any concern about is that smoking is an early symptom of lung cancer. You know, I've been a primary care doctor a long time. Nobody ever comes to your office and says, here to say, I've never smoked in my life. One morning I wake up, there's a lit cigarette in my hand, and I'm smoking it. And the doctor says, oh, that could be an early symptom of lung cancer. We better go. That's just not really an issue. But in depression and dementia, it really is an issue. We really have trouble deciding, is depression a symptom of dementia? Is it an early symptom of dementia? Or does having a propensity to have depression make it more likely you're going to get dementia? This is a quandary. I'm going to go over some of the data, but I'm not going to give you an answer because it's confusing. Now, there really aren't great treatments for smoking, but there's a patch for smoking and there are pills for smoking. And again, nobody's really concerned that the nicotine patch or the bupropion cause lung cancer. But we're going to talk about some concern that electroconvulsive therapy might cause a higher incidence of dementia. Or antidepressant drugs might cause a higher incidence of dementia. And so you can see how much more complicated this is, and how I wish I really could if I didn't speak about lung cancer. So easy. Well, maybe on this slide for a long time. So they asked for learning objectives, and I want you all at the end of the next 18 minutes to be experts on the interrelationships between depression and dementia. and we will talk about the risk factors for dementia. Now, first of all, I'm using the word here, prevalence. Prevalence means at this point in time, one point in time. Let me explain, it's not such a great thing for conditional depression. Because it turns out depression is more likely to be a recurring illness than a once-in-a-lifetime illness. So the prevalence in older people is actually not all that high, it's between 3-4% or so. But the lifetime chance that you will have depression is significantly higher, as much as 20%. So I look at depression as a condition very closely related to anxiety. The most common mental illness, as you may know, is generalized anxiety disorder, with a couple flavors of panic disorder and so forth, but really an anxiety disorder. And that's something you have pretty much all the time. But in those people, there's an amazingly high incidence of also episodically, like maybe every 10 years or every 8 years, having depression. And in the American population, the world population, this constellation of anxiety and depression is the most common condition in the realm of mental illness. It's so common that it's going to make it confusing as we start to talk about its interaction with another common syndrome, and that is dementia. As Dr. Rosen raised about Alzheimer's disease is one of the causes of dementia, but it unto itself is common with about a 6.5% incidence in people over 65. And as Dr. Rosen mentioned, a incidence that goes up and up and up with age, being more than a third of people that are 90 and old. So when you have two common conditions, depression and dementia, the interaction gets to be quite complicated. So we want to ask the question, can depression be an early symptom of progressive dementia? Dr. Rosen mentioned that neuropsychiatric symptoms are very common in Alzheimer's disease and other dementias. He mentioned traumatic brain injury, an older term for that, for those of us that are older, there's dementia pugilistica, the kind of dementia that boxers get. And I just can't tell you what a bad combination in my practice it was to deal with aggressive and irritable, usually men, that are former amateur or professional boxers. You do not want to be the spouse of such a person. That is a bad combo. Well, depression can be a very problematic symptom in the setting of dementia. And it also puts a tremendous burden on caregivers. Perhaps not as sudden and urgent as having a boxer punch you, but equally burdensome and long run. Let's also talk about whether depression or depressive symptoms, subsyndromal depression, can lead to an increased risk of dementia, and then the treatment. So I'll start with a relatively recent study that looked prospectively at people 75 and older, and every 18 months they checked these people. They did a screening thing. And the conclusion of that large prospective study is people with depression did not have a significantly higher incidence of developing dementia than people without depression. Good, so Dr. Luxenberg gave us the answer. Oh, no, it never works that way. So here's another study for cognitively normal people, in this case, 50 years old, again followed by more than 7 years. Now, these are expensive studies. When you apply for a research grant, usually for a period of 3 years, at least if it's from the NIH, you do these 7-year studies, but that's not a lot of them for that very reason. The other aspect, people in academia, they actually like to publish a paper before 7 years, helps with your promotion and things. In this case, people who developed dementia were about twice as likely to have depressive symptoms prior to reaching the diagnostic criteria for dementia. And so those two studies are essentially contradictory. But it brings up that question. Look at the difference in methodology. One, you're taking people that develop dementia and comparing them. And the other, you're following people and looking prospectively for a diagnosis. It's a subtle difference, but in this case, the question is, what if an early symptom of the dementia was depressive symptoms? This study would have identified that, but that's not saying depression causes dementia. It is saying, oh, before you have the diagnostic criteria, which we know are pretty strict. It's more than just memory impairment. Maybe you are demonstrating psychiatric symptoms early. So the conclusion is jury is still somewhat out. Okay, now let me tell you one of the sad stories. As Lake is so kind to regale you with, I did some research on dementia at the National Institute of Health many years ago, and then I went into private practice. And I go to private practice, and I have, there's one thing that after you hang up your shingle and you put your listing in the yellow pages, for those of you that are putting up yellow pages, it's like a website. You don't have any patients. That was the problem, you know, on day one, it was very lonely. So, because I did train in San Francisco, a lot of my friends had gone into private practice before then, and so they send you a gift. The gift is the consult. They send you a patient in from their practice that's having, in my case, memory problems, and they send them to me as a geriatric consult. So, the first month or so that I was in practice, a friend of mine sent me this woman. Memory problems, the family was very concerned. Long story, I examined her, and clearly she has some symptoms of depression. She actually meets the criteria for major depression. When I look how she was failing on her memory tests, she just wasn't trying very hard. So, you know, you're all familiar with the screening tests like the email state and open now. If you're asking the person to answer a question, if they're really depressed, then, I don't know. So I did something. Oh, let me tell you an idea how long ago this was. I started her on tricyclic antidepressants. That was all we had. It was before SSRIs. So anyway, she got better. And when she got better, her memory completely went back to normal. The family thought I was. Jeez. My friend that had referred her to me thought I was great. And this was what we used to call pseudo-dementia. Symptoms of depression mimic a dementia syndrome, but they completely reverse if you treat the depression. I was so smart for about a year. But I made a mistake. I'll tell you, don't ever ask people to come back for following. You will seem so smart if you never follow up with them. But as you might imagine, what happened is about a year later, memory complaints recurred without depressive symptoms, and what became out of it is she was developing dementia syndrome, and that initial combination, really, of memory complaints and depression was a very early symptom of her many illness, initially presenting as depression, responding to treatment, but then unfortunately progressing and becoming an ongoing problem. So I used to believe much more in pseudo-dementia than I do now. Maybe it still occurs every now and then. If the person's really cured, and if you follow them for a long time, they never get dementia and they die in a car accident or something. But in my experience, more often than not, when you think it's pseudo-dementia and they do get better with initial treatment, if you follow them long enough, they will develop dementia syndrome. Many, many years ago, I was involved in naming this constellation of symptoms, behavioral and psychological symptoms of dementia. And that's a story in itself, but now if we do cross-sectional analysis of people who have dementia, you see that major and minor depressive symptoms are very, very prevalent in the setting of dementia. And whether it's a quarter or whatever, it's higher in people who have a family history of dementia. And so I do think there is some overlap. You have a biologic predisposition to depression, and you have dementia. You put them together, and you are more likely to develop depression in dementia. There are some wonderful studies looking at biologic markers like the serotonin transporter protein that suggest that people with dementia who have the same levels that predispose to depression in the general population, they're more likely to have the coexistence into the depression in the setting of dementia. This is short, thank goodness we're running out of time. The ECT studies are actually very convincing that ECT does not result in a higher incidence of dementia. That's good because ECT is often the only effective therapy. Antidepressant drugs having a disappointing degree of efficacy in the setting of depression. If you think that's bad, in a moment I'll be telling you about their efficacy in the setting of dementia. That's really bad. The question one might ask, if there is a question that depression predisposes to dementia, maybe it's not the biologic condition of depression, it's how we treat depression. Now, as you may know, in fact, very recently there was a publication partly out of UCSF from Christine Hoppe's group that anticholinergic drugs predispose to dementia. And some of the antidepressants, including those tricyclics that I used to use, are very anticholinergic. And so the question is, if you've taken antidepressant drugs, are you more likely to get dementia? And this recent study does suggest that that's true. There's about a 2-to-1 odds ratio if you started to use antidepressant drugs, particularly if you started before age 65, and then lifetime development of dementia. Unfortunately, the meta-analysis does hint that there is a confounding effect. So again, it's so hard. I want this to be the theme of my talk to tease out the possibility that in fact depression was an early symptom of dementia, and therefore you got the drugs, and therefore statistically there's that odds ratio to 1. Very, very challenging. Now, this another theme seems to be finding contradictory things, and yes, there's this 2-to-1 increased likelihood of dementia if you take an antidepressant. However, there's evidence that one of the antidepressants, citalopram, actually has biologic effects, including reduction in amyloid protein production, that in transgenic Alzheimer's disease mice and healthy individuals, you would think is good for preventing Alzheimer's disease. We're looking for drugs that decrease amyloid production. And here we have one that's antidepressant. So, Dr. Luxenberg, how do you reconcile all the impressions plus dementia and pure dementia? Okay, this is the status slide. So, Craig Olson is the head of geriatric psychiatry at UCSF. He publishes these wonderful meta-analyses. He did great meta-analyses on antidepressants in the elderly, showing that antidepressants work in the elderly. And then, a few years later, he published one on all the clinical trials of antidepressant therapy on depression in demented elderly people. And they had absolutely no difference from giving people a placebo in terms of efficacy. But they had lots of difference in terms of side effects. So the antidepressant drugs were associated with falls in elderly. You would also like them to treat the depression. But in the setting of dementia, that evidence suggests they don't. And doctors always follow evidence, right? We're evidence-driven. No! It turns out 88% of people who have both the diagnosis of depression and dementia are receiving antidepressants. And I'll tell you, it's such a challenge. Because as a clinician, I want to do something. I know these drugs work on people without dementia. It's so hard not to like that prescription. But I do believe, given the current state of evidence, that non-pharmacologic means need to be your first, second, and third approach in dementia. If you walk out with that, I am done. Yay! It's not fun. Yeah, I see the moderator sweating. Thank you so much for your attention.